Hi, I'm Yan, a product manager here at Cambridge Intelligence. Today, we're going to show you how to use our Figma Design Kit. If you've ever faced challenges when designing UIs with complex graph or timeline visualizations, or if you've experienced the inevitable friction in the handover between your design team and the engineering team, you're not alone. Bringing your vision to life can be a challenging and time-consuming thing, and we get that. That's where our Figma Design Kit comes in. Whether you're prototyping concepts, rapidly iterating on designs for a quick go to production, or if you just need to quickly cobble together a proof of concept to get more stakeholder buy-in for your awesome project idea, we've got you covered. In this short video, Claire, our lead designer, is going to take you through exactly how to use the kit, highlight to you all the key features, just get you up and running with it super quickly. Over to you, Claire.
Hi, everyone. I'm Claire. I'll be running through the Figma kit that we have available. So I'm going to start with the people who might want to just quickly drop, copy and paste a chart into their own UI to show their stakeholders or just kind of test things out. So you'll come over here into our templates section and you'll see there's a few different use cases here. I'm just going to show you this top one for now. So the structure is that you have all of the components on the left. These all then control the static examples on the right. So you'll see there's just a normal chart, then a chart with an open combo. So you might want to flow from that one to that one with a click or whatever you want to choose for your design. Then different ways of like highlighting paths and backgrounding others. So you can see this node here is backgrounders. And here's an example with comment on. So that's our annotations feature within the product. And then just some other screens that you might find useful. So two open combos in a screen as well. This is our like social media analysis chart, which you might have seen before on our sites. And then obviously you can just use the components over here. So like, for example, if you didn't want that glyph to be that color, you could swap it. And that's going to update on all of the screens that I just showed you. So that's really easy for designers who want to do something quickly, but also if you're a product manager and you want to just drop something into a presentation, it's really easy to come over here and just copy this chart and drop it in. We've got other examples here. So this is an example of an IT network. I'll just show you this one because it shows a different shape of combo. Obviously, there's a lot of different options within our products. So you can see here, you can nest combos within combos, or you can have them in different layouts as well. So this is like a grid layout. You can close one combo and you can see there you've got a little glyph that shows you how many nodes are within that combo. So those are some really good examples that you can use these sort of highlighted paths and again, sort of backgrounded elements that you can see. And you can use these templates to just sort of edit what you like, change this node, whatever you want to do, and then it will update the static screens there. Another really good one that we've got is quite commonly used. You'll have some data in a table on your UI and then a chart, and then you might also want a timeline because your data has time in it. So that's another really good one, and that's in the templates too. So then I'm going to move on to how you might want to build your own library from scratch to match your brand. So this is a node library. You've got basic nodes here and then some more complex nodes. So these are actually nodes with a label inside them. And these are different things. So you've got icons here, which you can swap in with any of the icons that's already in this library, or you can obviously import your own and swap in your own icons here. And then moving over to labels. So there's a bit of a label gallery here. So you can use any of these labels in this gallery, or, you know, you can create your own. This is an example of like a node with a label on it. So all the different positions that are commonly used, plus the fact that you can swap these in for some of the labels up here. And I'll show you how that works in a minute. And again, we have a thing called a glyph, which you might have heard of before. And it's a similar situation. So you can put a glyph next to a node, or you can put it on a link. And then you've got a couple of examples here of a node from the library plus a glyph from the library. And you can put those on using the components that have already been ready-made here. And then you've got donuts. So donuts are used for lots of things. You might want to see that this group here has 50% this and 50% that, or use our donut to show percentage. And then sometimes people use them for menus, so you can have different buttons around your node. So I'll just show you some links quickly. So this is a really basic set of links. You've got straight ones with arrows going this way and that. And then you've got the curved links as well, as well as our angled links. Then onto combos. You can see here we've put a couple of layouts in the combos that are quite commonly used. So here you'll see a grid layout, which is used when there's not many links in your data. So if you've got just a set of nodes that you want to just neatly put together, a grid layout is really good. Then you've got your kind of flow layout, which is left to right. So you can see those in there, and you might want to go top down. And then again, quite commonly used is a concentric circle arrangement as well. And then again, a bit like the nodes, you've got combos with labels on, and I'll show you how they can be used within the kit. And then again, you've got the nested combos, which you saw in the templates, but there's a couple of other examples here. Moving on to our annotations. So our timeline annotations work slightly differently to the annotations in regraph and keylines. So we've got two sets here. There's timeline annotations that you can use, and a couple of examples of how they display on your chart if you want to just copy paste. And over here, you've just got all the elements to add an annotation to your network chart. So you show your subjects, and then you connect that with your annotation, and you can have that in a couple of different ways. And there's a few examples there. The layouts, again, a bit similar to the combos. We have a lot of different layouts that the product does for you. So here's a couple of examples of those, and I'll show you how you can quickly turn that into your chart using what's in the library. And then our timeline product, chronograph, and all of the elements to create your timeline here. Or again, just some really quick examples that you could copy and paste. So I'm going to head back over to the node library and show you how our variables work. You'll see here you've got a node inside with a donut around it. Now let me just show you. So if I open up our variables, now to start with, you have primitives in your variables, which you might have heard that name for if you're working on a design system or something. And it works exactly the same way. So you've got colors in there, you've got border radius values, spacing values, whatever spacing system you're using, you can put it in. We've got some other things like font families and font sizes that you might want to change and add depending on your brand. And it's kind of up to you how you use this part. So you could replace all the basics. You know, you're only working on one brand, you can just put that in. Or of course, if you're working on a couple of brands, you want to test it on a few different ones, then you can add modes. And I've just added a couple of examples here. Let me just see if I can show you how that works. If I create a section here that says my brand, and I'll just take this donut and I'll drop it in. Now, if I have a look on appearance on the right-hand side panel, I can see that it's automatically selecting basic, which is the default mode for this kit. So I'm going to select my brand, and it's going to change the colors a little bit. And then I can also test it on my brand too, which is similar, but if you've inputted your own colors, you'll instantly see the icon color you want plus the background or the border or whatever else you've put in there. So moving on from that, let me just open up the variables panel again. We've got this collection, which is all of your primitives, which then controls everything within styles. So if I just select this donut around a node again, let me change that back to auto. So if I just click on that one there, you can see if I run down to colors here in the right hand panel, we've got all of these colors here, and this is connected to all the styles here. Now, what we've done as much as possible in here is match the naming conventions to what's in our API, which is something that Jan just touched on a little bit in the introduction. So I'll just show you that for this here donut. this donut is our segmented donut. So I'm going to find segmented donut, and you'll see you've got segments and then you've got colors in the segments. So that corresponds with how the layout is in our API. So if you have a look over here, you can see we've got donuts, segmented donut, segments, color one. Some of those, like segmented donut, you might just put donuts within your code, but actually that's the hierarchy. That's the way that it goes in the code. So you've got that's the way that it's laid out. So you've got donut segments and then your color, and you'll add your different colors for all the segments. So that's how our variables work. I'm just gonna touch on some of the other features that we use within Figma, which is things like nested instances and instance swap properties. So you'll come up here. I just find a good one to use. Let's have a look at this node. So if I want this node and this label, but actually I don't really want this node and this label, I want a different node. So you'll come up here and you'll see we've got, I want a different label this time. So I've got basic node label. And that there, that's an instance swap property. So what I can do here is I can open this up and I can see a couple of the labels that are in this kit. And then, of course, you can add your own. So I want this one, I want this curvy one because I like it. And then from there, you can just start changing it. So I don't want it in the north position. I'm going to put it in the east position for now. And actually, this node, I think I'm going to have an icon on it. And actually, I don't want that kind of icon. Let's just change that. Right, so then you've got a different icon, a different node. I'm going to remove that background. I'm going to change that, take that off. And there I'm starting to build up my own node. So the way that this is set up is, as Jan mentioned, there's hundreds of different elements within this, but it's more about the combinations that you can make. So you can have this node with that label, this node with that glyph. I can show you over here. I've got another one. Let's bring that one with us and put it over here. So now I've got this, and then I can kind of start adding this warning one in here. So this is a warning. And from there, I can start building my chart. So I'm going to take us over to layouts. I'm going to bring these nodes with me that I've just made. So if I go to layouts, and I find this one, I've got this nice one with the angled links with the labels. So I'm going to copy that one. And you can probably predict what's coming, really. But if I save this node and put my node, and then I'm going to put this one as my warning node. And then I'm going to have at the top, I'm going to show, I'm going to just quickly swap these for the node that I just made there. And then you can quickly see that you can start editing this chart here. Let's just select all of these ones. I'm going to get that node and I'm going to swap it in. So what I'm doing is I'm just copying the name and then I'll swap those in. And you can quickly see, especially with this one, if I just go in here and reduce that all the way down, I can start building, and then I can just get these links, and I've decided that I want to change those links as well. So I'm going to change those to a dashed one so that you can see really quickly that the chart is becoming my own. And so I can use the library here, swap all these things in, and then copy and paste that into my UI or wherever I want to go. So I'm just going to move over here and just touch on a quick thing about the variables as well. You might look at something like this and go, oh, that's loads of colors. How am I ever going to replace those colors? But if I just click on that element, and I'll just show you here, you can see there's a timeline entity one color and timeline entity two color. So that's only two colors that you'll need to replace in your variables. Or of course, if you wanted to just detach from variables and just go AWOL, then you could just change the colors, but you'd still only have to change two. So let's find this entity one. I'm just going to show you what happens. Let's go for a nice light purple. And then hopefully you'll see that change. And you'll see across the library, especially in the timeline, all of the elements, they're all connected to the color that I just changed in the variable. So you only have to change it once, and then you can copy paste these elements in. There's an element of responsivity in these options as well. So if I expand that to the right there, make it wider, then you can see that the timeline has expanded as well as some of the elements in between. And you'll see that there'll be some messing about. You have to do, like, you'll have to change these entity options here as well. But as much as possible, we've got the responsivity in there. So again, let me just go back to here and just reiterate what I mentioned about our API. So you'll see, for example, this basic glyph, if I just copy that one, sometimes you'll see, as I mentioned, in the variables, we've got the naming conventions from our API within the variables as closely as possible. But sometimes you'll see these in properties as well. So we have in our labels, for example, you can have label bold, true or false, and that's reflected up here in a Boolean. So you can turn that on and off, and that reflects exactly how it would work in the code when you were building with our products. So when you're speaking to your developer and they're asking about these things, you can point them towards these properties and the variables so that they know what to build. So I'm gonna pass over to Jan now, and he's gonna let us know how we can access the Figma kit.
So just a quick wrap up from me. The design kit is available to our customers and evaluators right now as part of our early access program. So if you're already using our SDKs, then just contact your customer success manager and you can get a copy today. We also really appreciate any feedback you might have for us, so please don't hesitate to reach out. Thank you.